Thank you for watching this video. If you're a subscriber, sure do appreciate it. If not, consider doing so. And don't forget to give this video a thumbs up.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to my side of the shop on the Upper East Side of Texas, where summer has arrived. It's about 95 degrees here in the shop with about equal amount of humidity. It is hot out here. So I'm going to make this video rather brief, and then I'm going to go back inside where the air conditioning is. From the last video, and this is a continuation about the Upshur engine project and rebuilding the carburetor. If you recall from the previous video, I went ahead and cranked that engine up for you. It's about 15 years ago when I built the engine, and the carburetor needs some tweaking on it. The needle valve does not exactly match up like I want it to do, so I'm going to rebuild the carburetor on this, and it's an interesting, very small project, but a fun project nevertheless. Let me tell you what's going to happen in this video and how I'm going to go about building the carburetor. The carburetor on this engine is a 1/4 inch solid stock that I'm going to drill 5/32 through. Now, this engine does not have a Ventura on it. It is a straight 5/32 drill through. I'm also going to have 1/8 inch solid stock that I'll be threading on one side of that tube, and on the other side is a drill through where the gas comes in, and I'll have to build a metering valve or a jet, and I'm going to use a 256 screw, put about a 24 degree angle on that thing. And now there's a couple of tricky parts that I'm going to have to do in this video, in this project. Let me show you what they are and go over the material list here. This is the entire thing, or all the components that I'll be using. This 1/4 inch rod right here, solid rod, is actually this piece right here that I'll be replacing the hex stock with. The brass is what's going to be going across this way, so I'll need to, and it's solid, so I've got to drill through both sides of that, thread one side, and then on the other side will be my jet, or be the orifice where the jet goes into. The needle valve itself is actually going to be a 256 bolt. I'll, again, put about a 24 degree angle on that. That's just going to be something that I will knurl to be able to turn the metering valve with. And that's really all the parts that I'll need. I'll talk about those two parts in the next video, because there's really two tricky things that I'm going to have to do here. One of the tricky things is going to be, how do I drill center across the diameter of that? And second is, this solid rod is going to have to be cut in two, yet it's got to have a space between it. How is that going to be lined up from the screw side over to where the jet is? And I'll show you how we'll do that in the next video. Before I leave, though, I want to talk about two things that sometimes can get confusing, especially if you're not familiar or just moving into the concept of building internal combustion engines that are modeled after some of the early farm engines. There's really two types of engines that the early farm had on it as far as gasoline engines, and people still collect those and rebuild those today. One type of engine is called a hit and miss engine, and the other engine is called a throttle governing engine. Now, the engine that I'm using right here is more akin to the throttling governor. It's not exactly throttling governor, but it's the closest of those two that it is. The difference between those two is this. The hit and miss engine is a very interesting engine. The way that engine runs, and you may have seen those, you know, they usually pop, pop, and they'll only fire so many revolutions. Here's what's going on. When that flywheel is turning, the flywheel has a governor, and the governor, the momentum is spreading the governor out like this, and of course, as it slows down, the governor gets closer and closer together. The governor is attached to a rod that's also connected up to the intake valve. When the governor speed collapses far enough, it actually trips the rod that controls the, or holds the intake valve open, and it lets that intake valve close. When the intake valve closes, two things happen. It sucks air through the carburetor with your fuel-air mixture, and it also, now you have compression in your cylinder, so you get another explosion. When you get your explosion, or the cylinder fires, then the speed immediately increases, and the governors fly apart, and the engine, for all practical purposes, starts coasting again until it slows down. The momentum closes the governor, and the process starts all over again. The throttle governing engine does not have the valve set up like the hit and miss engine has. The speed is controlled by the throttle itself and how much gas or how much fuel the engine is receiving. Now, the throttling governor engine is much more complex than my simple engine, but this engine right here will have the speed controlled by the amount of gas that's actually going through the carburetor. It has no other governors on it whatsoever, and yet it will still run fine. We're going to see that on the next video and see how that works, guys. If you have not subscribed, I really encourage you to do so and hope you would. Give the video a thumbs up, share the video. If you build engines or if you have any questions about hit and miss engines, model engines, or throttle governing engines, or anything that you'd like to see within this project, put them down in the comment below. I'll be sure to answer those. In the meantime, we'll see you on the next video where we build this carburetor and do those little interesting little machining operations. And from the Upper East Side of Texas, this is John, and we'll see you later.